Welcome to this retreat at home to mark the end of 2020 and the beginning of 2021. In readiness for this session, you might find it helpful to find your diary or a calendar from 2020, your address book, and a candle with a battery or a light which can remain on overnight. Just pause the video if you need to go and find them. In this session, there will be some spoken input from me, the opportunity to ponder and reflect, to pray and to listen to God. And then tomorrow morning on the Zoom gathering, there will be further opportunity to listen and then some social time. Today marks the end of one calendar year and the threshold of another. We mark many endings, many year endings. The end of the tax year in April sees government and individuals spending or moving money across bank accounts. The end of the connectional year for the people called Methodists sees some ministers moving and circuits getting ready for a change in staff team. The liturgical year ends in November amid a flurry of Bible readings about warnings and signs. The end of the calendar year is tonight, and a good time for reviewing and reflecting on these past 12 months. We hear about time from the very first verses of the book of Genesis and the creation story unfolding over 7 days. The book of Ecclesiastes has a lot to say about time. There is a season for everything under heaven. When Jesus' disciples ask him, "What will be the sign of your coming and what will be the signs of the end of the age?" Jesus replies, "No one knows the day or the time except the Father." Anxieties around when and not knowing when are quite difficult and particularly pertinent at the moment. Nevertheless, to a greater or lesser extent, in tune with our natural inclination or not, we live an ordered life. Days, weeks, and years divide into work, sleep, leisure, worship, prayer, and household administration. Have I renewed the TV license? When is the MOT due? Recycling. Which week is it? Medication. Have I already had my tablet for today? Appointments, liturgical year, lectionary year. Is it an Olympic year? A leap year? When is Easter? All of these are a backdrop to busyness as well as a rule of life. But now a prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Lord, as we leave the day behind and seek rest, we commit to you the stresses and worries that we have carried. We breathe deeply and thank you that you refresh our souls. We thank you for each sunrise and sunset we have seen, and pray that we will feel your presence tomorrow when we wake. Amen. American John Greenleaf Whittier was a Quaker who firmly believed that God was best worshipped in silent meditation. This familiar verse is drawn from an interlude in his long and somewhat eccentric poem called The Brewing of Soma. Drop thy still dews of quietness till all our strivings cease. Take from our souls the strain and stress, and let our ordered lives confess the beauty of thy peace. In the peace, I invite you to consider how this last year has felt. Perhaps peace has been hard to find. Maybe there have been seasons which were too short. On the other hand, in this pandemic year, some months may have felt like an eternity. Perhaps particular words, feelings, or pictures encapsulate your mood. There's going to be some music in a few moments, and as it plays over 4 or 5 minutes, I invite you to write or sketch the words or feelings you're thinking about now. Perhaps a particular psalm comes to mind. Use the time to read it again and note words or verses which stand out. The music lasts about 5 minutes, but if you need more time, just pause the video and return when you're ready. Today seems the right time to look back over the year as a remembering, a laying down, a confession maybe, or thankfulness as an offering. A glance over the year or some careful examination will reveal some diamonds in the dust, moments of unexpected joy, kindness is shown, mercies received. A few days ago, the man next door brought me a cake he'd baked for Christmas. Earlier in the year, I received anonymously some chocolate in the post. Perhaps you did too. This slide shows a sunflower which grew unexpectedly. The seeds I'd planted all seemed to die in the early part of the summer. And then when I was looking out of the kitchen window in September, I glanced across and saw a splash of yellow, went to investigate at the same time as this bee did. I wonder, how have you been blessed this year? As the next piece of music plays, look back through your diary or calendar, noting appointments, meetings, even the crossed out engagements. Give thanks for things that have taken place, or even for some things which to some relief didn't, and give thanks. This year inevitably has contained regrets. There may well be some occasions where we wish we could go back and respond differently. And then there have been other times when we, reflecting honestly, know we could have done nothing about what happened. But creation is forgiving. This is a picture of the riverbank raised in Herefordshire recently. A lot of damage was caused, but creation will find a way of renewing that earth. Happily, scripture provides examples of a way back, of reorientation, confession, repentance, and forgiveness. One of the songs that we sing at the centre quite often includes the words, "He makes a way where there is no way." A quote I found recently, and which I'm still pondering on, says this: "I do not think you should let go of your sin until you have learned what it has to teach you." Or maybe put another way, this bowl of kitchen waste contains peelings which have served their purpose. These eggshells, used for scrambled eggs a few days ago, represent something which some may consider unfulfilled, but which has come to an end. But when added to garden compost, provides the very best nutrients for the future. I wonder, what are the regrets or disappointments of this year, which could well be life-giving in the future? So take a few moments to write and draw in picture form any regrets or disappointments from this year, including wrongs done to you. And consider what God wants to say to you about these.
Paint you the Milky Way. again. Here far below the lies you were told, come and let the healing begin. Someone you trusted but never knew twisted your joy into shame.
Almost inevitably, there will have been friends, family members, acquaintances we have said goodbye to this year because they have died. You might want to pause and read the pages of your address book, noticing the gaps. Thank God for the place each one has in your heart. Write a message or a paragraph which sums up their impact on your life. This year may also have brought losses of relationship, friendships which have changed in nature, loss of employment and your place in an organisation, loss of value as a volunteer, or a loss of status or income. Allow yourself time and space to remember, to cry. Offer these feelings to God in prayer.
Thank you.
At the end of each day recorded in Genesis, the author says, "And it was evening, and it was morning, day one. And it was evening, and it was morning, the second day." By mentioning evening before morning, Genesis defines a day as beginning with the evening, followed by the morning. This definition of the passage of time is not only relevant to how we set up a calendar, it has profound implications as to our outlook on life itself. Everyone agrees that life is full of ups and downs. We go through periods where the sun is shining on us and we feel on top of the world, only to turn a corner and be faced with difficulties and obstacles which drag us down. But it isn't often long before something pleasant comes our way to pick us up again. The question is, which wins the day, the ups or the downs? In other words, is life a series of disappointments dotted by the occasional glimmer of hope, only to be crushed by another surge of gloominess? Or are we on a journey upwards with challenges along the way, which make us even stronger in our quest for enlightenment? Does darkness extinguish light, or does light conquer darkness? Does day follow night, or does night follow day? The biblical view is clear. And it was evening, and it was morning. First the night, and then the day. Darkness is a pathway to the sunrise hiding behind it. A challenge comes our way only to help us tap into and reveal our inner powers that have until now remained unfathomed. There is comfort in knowing that no matter how dark it may seem, it is light that will have the last word. And so we pray. God of all time, who makes all things new, we bring before you the year now ending, for life full and good, for opportunities recognised and taken, for love known and shared, we thank you. Where we have fallen short, forgive us. When we worry over what is past, free us. As we leave this year and take steps into the future, where nothing is safe and certain except you, we ask for the courage of the Magi who simply followed the light of the star. We ask for their wisdom in choosing to pursue the deepest truth, not knowing where they would be led. In the year to come, God of all time, be our help and our presence. Take us by the hand as we journey on, and may your dream of shalom, where all will be at peace, be our guiding light. Amen. In this last act for this mini retreat, I invite you to switch on your candle or a light which can be left on overnight. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life."